in there somewhere.
I know, exactly.
You just remember that New Year's resolution you made to try new things. I can imagine, yeah.
The world of indie. Get a free trial of YouTube Music Premium today.
Come on, we're going back on the record. later when you're
Do you want to move?
1, 2
Thank you.
Yes. Hallelujah. You're still in charge, Lord, even of anything that's going on. And I've decided to sing a very old song. But the words are, I feel, appropriate for this time. Be bold.
Yes.
Be strong. For the Lord your God is with you. That she died of, and it's a little bit more rare, I think. So they're doing quite a lot of research, and they need funding for that. So we raised £108.80, which is great. So Heather will have set that off for us. So that's the AMMF. If you want to look it up online, it'll give you some more information. Okay. So we're in lockdown from Monday, aren't we? Really, Tuesday we started a new lockdown. And I just want to give thanks and just tell you a little bit of what's happening. First of all, we had some food sent to us this week from Moorend School, because obviously they ordered a lot of food and they don't need it all, so they sent us some on Friday, which is great. We've had another lady come yesterday with a load of food, so that's brilliant. But having said that, our cupboard is a little bare, because we've actually fed 30 families yesterday. 17 boxes went out, 11 people came through the door, one was collected for two other people, so that's 13. So that's about 30 people altogether, household-wise. So we just want to pray that God replenishes us, helps us to replenish our stocks. And also I've run around a few people, so we're going to pray for them as I go along. Some have had an accident. Alan has fallen and broken his hip and his elbow. They've operated on his hip. But his elbow, but not his hip, because they can't do that. So we'll be praying for him. Don has broken his wrist, so he's not able to help out at food bank. So there's a number of people that are struggling in our membership, so I will be praying for them as well. Okay, but let's just start. God wants to speak to us, and he wants us to be prepared, and he wants us to open our hands and say, yes, Lord, I'm going to receive everything that you have to give me today. So let's prepare in that mode. Lord, we thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you, Lord, for more end and for all that they've given us as a school, and they support us and we support them. We thank you for them, Lord. We thank you for the lady that came with a lot of food yesterday, who's wanting to bless us. And we know there's people in our fellowship that bless us regularly. We thank you for them, Lord. But we do need right now to replenish our stocks. So we just pray, Lord, you'll continue to provide as you have done for us in the past so generously. And so we just thank you in anticipation for what we know that you're going to bring to each one of us. We pray, Lord, for Alan as he's in hospital. He's had an operation on his elbow and his hip. He can't operate, but Lord, we know he's already fallen again in hospital because trying to stand on it, he can't take the weight. So we pray for Alan, Lord. Pray you'll be very near to him. Pray for Francis, that you'll be with Francis at home. We pray for Dawn as well, Lord. Ian's in hospital at the moment. And Lord, we just want to pray and bring your healing power. Lord, that you would shrivel up those tumours, Lord, that we know that he's got there as well. We want, Lord, to have a real healing for Ian. And we continue to ask and pray because we are expectant. So we pray you'll be with Dawn while she's on her own at home as well. I pray for Marion as well, Lord. I spoke to Marion this week and she's waiting to go to Blackpool to discuss an operation that's going to help her breathing and her heart issues. So I pray that you go with her, Lord, at the end of the month, towards the end of the month, and she goes for that appointment in Blackpool, and you just give her wisdom, Lord, and help her to make the right decision on what's going to happen. We pray for Jean, Lord, who's looking after Dave, and we pray and give her the strength that she needs in order to do that. We thank you, Lord, that we've heard that people have already received the vaccine. Some of our people have, and some have even had two, which is brilliant. But we pray, Lord, that these vaccines will be able to be given out as soon as they can for protection. Lord, but I want to just read from 1 John. Chapter 4, verse 18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Jesus is our perfect one. Jesus is the one that brings us that perfect love. So if we belong to Jesus and we are standing in with him today, then that perfect love casts out all fear. And if we are fearful about COVID or anything else that we might be fearful today, God's perfect love casts out that fear, and we need to put that into our practice, that if we belong to Jesus, that fear can go, because we're relying on him and he's not a God who lets us down. And so help us, Lord Jesus, each one of us that are struggling today, to trust you and to believe what we trust in, not just with our head, but with our hearts as well, so that we step into that reality that you are a God who we can trust and who casts out all our fears. And so, Lord Jesus, we just pray that as we continue in this new lockdown, Lord, we pray that you be with us, you bring us your peace and your joy. Even in this situation, you can bring us joy. If we know you and trust you, you can bring us the joy that we need, because we belong to you. And so we pray, Lord, for each one of us as a membership, for all our members, we pray that you be with them, and for our community, Lord, that you would just bless. And we think of all of our pharmacies and those that are still working, for our nurses and our doctors and all of those, Lord, are still working on the front line, that you too would give them the strength and the courage and the peace that they need, Lord, in order to perform their regular duties and far above what they're having to do. We know that a lot of nurses and doctors are struggling at the moment. And so we pray, Lord, that you would just send your angels around them, that you would just bring that peace that they need, Lord, right now, and that you would just be with them, knowing, Lord, that you're there all the time, If we just ask, you're there, right alongside us, helping us all the time. And we just pray that all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. We're just going to sing one song more, and then Arnold's going to come and speak to us.
Thank you.
Give him your words to speak to him, that you would touch our hearts and open our hearts and our minds to listen in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah, if you got your Bible with you, we're going to be looking at the first part of the Bible this morning, just going back to this set of talks we were doing, which we broke into because Christmas was with us. So I want you to turn to me in the first part of the Bible, we call the Old Testament. And we're looking at the book of Numbers. So that's Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. Okay, it's the fourth book in the first part of the Bible. And we're looking at chapter 10. It's just this little passage again where the people of Israel are camped in the wilderness, and the Lord says to Moses, make two trumpets out of hammered silver. Use them for calling the community together and for having the camps to set out. Now when both are sounded, the whole community is to assemble before you at the entrance to the tent of meeting. If only one is sounded, the leaders of the clans of Israel are to assemble before you. And when a trumpet blast is sounded, the tribes camping on the east set out, and at the sounding of a second blast, camps on the south are to set out. So the blast on the trumpet will be the signal for setting out. To gather the assembly, blow the trumpets, but not with the same signal for setting out. Now it is the sons of Aaron, the priests, who are to blow the trumpets, and this is to be a lasting ordinance for you and the generations to come. When you go into battle in your own land against an enemy who is oppressing you, sound a blast on the trumpets, and you will be remembered by the Lord your God, and you will be rescued from your enemies. Also, at your times of rejoicing and celebration, your appointed festivals and new moon feasts, you are to sound the trumpets over your burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, and they will be a memorial for you before your God. For I am the Lord your God. So we just, yeah, Lord, we've asked you a blessing. Please speak to us now from this word, we pray together, and help us with our understanding of it. And I got this tremendous quote that picks up. I'm focusing on Numbers 10, the ninth verse is the one where God says, look, when you have to go to war, I want you to, against people who are oppressing you or whatever, I want you to blow these trumpets. And in the book of Exodus, that's the second book in the first part of the Bible, the Lord is described as a warrior. And Moses says, the Lord's a warrior, the Lord is his name, Pharaoh's chariots and his army, he is hurled into the sea. Now, when we come on this passage in Numbers, and it talks about Israel's involvement in war, that brings us to some of the most challenging texts in the Old Testament. Texts that upset a lot of people, and they're not easy to work with. So you notice that Dave here's got pictures of three chaps here up on the board, working from, as they say in these football photographs, working from left to right. The chap on the far left, a chap called Gerhard von Rad, he was a German thinker. The middle guy, Peter Craigie, he was from Lancaster there. Wow. Somebody's got to come from Lancaster, haven't they? Praise God. And then Greg Boyd, he's an American Christian thinker. All of these guys have presented different theories, slightly different theories on the Old Testament war texts. Now, Craigie and Boyd always linked the Old Testament and the New Testament together. And Boyd, in a quite profound act of thinking, suggests that we read the idea of Yahweh the warrior, he says, through the glasses, if you like, through the lenses of Jesus' death and resurrection. In other words, then, for Boydler, these texts about warfare are summed up in God's action in Jesus in the New Testament. Now, we'll see more of that in a minute, but I just wanted to fix in our minds here, because these texts do cause problems for people. So let's just have a look at a general kind of look at the background. The first thing is, you'll notice that in these texts, they are to do with God's rescue of Israel. God is fighting to fix Israel in his secure and open future. So it's not just, all right, yeah, we'll have a war, we'll kick off, we'll go kicking people up in the air. It's about God fixing Israel in a secure, open future. Now, that links with what he says in the fifth book of the Old Testament, first part of the Bible, a book called Deuteronomy. And there God says that part of the business of this war is about what he calls the detestable things that were in the culture before the Israelites arrived. Detestable things. Now, what God's word is showing here is that there was an anti-God culture in place, which was extremely destructive, firstly, of basic humanity. And that's one thing you always notice. When you've got a strong anti-God culture, it's often destructive of the idea of basic humanity. Now, in the Old Testament, that showed itself in things like, wait for it, child sacrifice was involved in Canaanite worship. That's hard for us to grasp today, but that was part of their thing. And God said, look, I'm sorry, but that is detestable to me. Treating children like that is detestable to me. And the second thing you notice, if you carefully read in that book of Deuteronomy, is that it is destructive. This anti-God culture is destructive of human sexuality. And the text hints at all kinds of perversions going on that are almost unthinkable even today. I find that strange that in the culture that we live in, which is not exactly for God, is it? You know, and you find this whole tension bias about basic humanity and human sexuality, and it's still going on. You know, we have a United Nations Charter of Human Rights, and our century is the century that's seen some of the worst abuses of human rights. You know, we're at the point now where, you know, Mark and I are preparing our report to the Charity Commission, which we have to do every year. You know, we have to put in a passage now about the fact we have a safeguarding officer. Whoever thought churches would have to have a safeguarding officer? You see, that is life today, isn't it? And you notice that the third element that's to do with this anti-God culture is a totalitarian, what we would call a totalitarian kingship. You see, in the Canaanite culture, everything feeds the king and his family at the top. See, the idea in their culture was get your family at the top and keep them there at all costs. It was a kind of what we would call, George Orwell terms, those of us who read Orwell, a big brother society. And Canaanite religion and practice shaped this anti-God, this anti-reasoning social contract that was to do with money, sex, and power. It was a kind of anything goes culture, provided it kept the king and the religion in place. Now, the interesting thing about this is people said, oh yeah, well, these Old Testament, these ancient texts, what do they know about anything? Now, here's the interesting thing. Modern archaeology has come to support the Torah, because a number of the statues and things they've uncovered in this area where they've done these bigger archaeological things all bear out what we're saying about the destruction of the human person and of human sexuality. And thirdly, when we notice the language of destruction in the war text, the destruction language is framed, look, listen, by saying these things are devoted to God's judgment. You see, in scripture, God is against anti-God, anti-human evil. He's against it. Well, you wouldn't be surprised by that, would we? If like the songs Angela, Dawn and Chris have led us in this morning, talking about the goodness of God. Well, if God is good, of course he's going to be anti-evil, isn't he? He doesn't want evil to flourish. Now, here's the reason again. God doesn't want evil to flourish because it opposes God's desire for a holy wholeness culture. You see, God wants an integration between us, him, creation that promotes the development of well-being, of health, of care, of nurture, good family, good technical design, welfare for people, for animals, for the natural environment. That's God's picture of what he wants for the world. That's expressed to us through the Bible, how modern the Bible is. And it begins in that first, very first book of the Bible, where God's view of the world he's made is it's good. It's good. It's good in the one who has made it, and it's good in what has been made. And in God's purpose, human and creation, humans and creation, we're to interact. The original purpose for God was we would interact under his guidance so that we would, for example, develop and sustain clean air and water. God's original purpose was for us as human beings to extend the beauty of the Garden of Eden right through all creation. Imagine that. Imagine the perfection and the beauty. And people say, oh yeah, well, they're just old stories. Oh, well, okay. But just read the story and you see the beautiful picture of life that is painted there. And God wanted that life to be extended throughout all creation, so he wanted a balance between human beings and our environment that is good for everyone. He didn't want us over-exploiting resources. He wanted us to make progress in eco-friendly power. Now, of course, the Bible doesn't cover this, but God's view would have covered such things as hybrid and electric engines and, you know, solar power. And God's intention would be that these good things would be made available to everyone, not just the latest pricey trends of global companies. You see, as you read through the Bible carefully, God purposes equality. He wants us to, he wants there to be life sharing. He wants there to be health care access for everyone, regardless of our ability to pay. He doesn't want there to be injustice. God doesn't want a world where there are luxury flats on the one hand, in which nobody's living because they're tax write-offs, and slums on the other. God, that's it's a disjunction. It's wrong. God wants there to be good education and good development. And he wants it to be right throughout society, not simply just to people who can afford it. And you say, well, where are you getting this from? Well, I'm getting it from the opening passages of the whole Bible, and I'm getting it from the final two passages of the Bible. Because the final vision that the Bible leaves us with is a beautiful picture of God's purpose as a recreated heaven and earth. A new kind and a new quality of humanity and of a new city in which there is no pain, no cancer, no suffering, no violence. There is no sorrow. There is no hatred. There is no social racism. There is no sickness. There's no dysfunction and dislocation. There's no disconnect between God and humans and creation. There's no more class, economic, or gender inequality. This is God's picture of the future that he has purposed for us. And this is why the idea that we've been speaking about for quite a while here at Union Road, this about God's mission through Jesus and the Holy Spirit and God's people, is so important, because our job as God's people, in His power, by His power, not on our own, of course, naturally, that through Jesus and the Spirit, we are meant to bring in this kind of culture. A culture of seeing God face to face, where the life atmosphere is ultimate healing. And final book of the Bible, all creation and all and humanity, those that have received Jesus, those who are in connection with Him, they come to this place of ultimate healing, where there is no death. But even if you read those last two chapters of the Bible, you will notice that there are exclusions. There are exclusions of negative people, negative life expressions. Now you notice what I'm saying. These Old Testament passages about the wars, they are the physical expressions of the New Testament spiritual reality. You see, the Bible as a whole, we are so used to thinking these days, you know, in terms of the kids' films, you know, Star Wars, ooh, the light side of the Force and the dark side of the Force in perfect balance. That's not what the Bible's talking about. The Bible's talking about something even deeper. The Bible is talking about the expulsion of everything from the universe that is anti-God. Now, this is why. Because it is destructive of God's good purpose. Now, that's a totally different picture of God from the one you were expecting this morning. Oh, God, the big guy up in the sky. Don't do this. Don't go there. Don't do that. Don't taste this. Don't play with that. See? This is the God of big purpose, who wants such a good life for human beings. And when we read these war texts through scriptures, one big true rescue story, we begin to notice something, and this too is very important. And people might say, oh, this sounds a bit involved, but listen now. Listen. This war language is written in the language of the Middle East. And the language of the Middle East is big on a language tool called, I can only say this once, answer and dawn again, ready to laugh at me now, hyperbole. See, and dawn, that's a big word. Okay, it means massive, deliberate exaggeration. See? So when it talks about destruction and wiping out, it's deliberate, massive exaggeration. Now, if you're familiar a little bit with Jesus' sayings, some of us heard them in school. Do you remember Jesus talking about a camel going through a needle's eye? See, hyperbole. He talked about how some religious people could strain a gnat out of their cup of tea and swallow a camel. Yeah. Imagine the difference. See, there's the massive, a tiny, tiny gnat. You cannot move it. Strain it out, he said. They'll strain it from what they drink, and they'll swallow a whole camel. Lots of us remember the famous parable of Jesus about the plank in your eye while you're trying to pick a splinter out of somebody else's. Mm-hmm. See, that is hyperbole, and that is the language in which these texts about the war are in. Because we know, if we read on in the big storyline, in the book of Judges and the book of Ruth, which come later in the Old Testament, Israel, of course, didn't completely destroy the anti-God cultures. The silly beggars went and involved themselves with them, until in the end, Israel's own culture broke down. They broke down their own social life, and God comes to them again and again through the Old Testament. Oh, he says, look, I told you to throw all these things, and now you're playing with them, and look what it's bringing. It's bringing in the same anti-human, anti-sexual behavior that the people that were in the land before, you see? Because here's an important point that I want to make. Israel in the Old Testament and the church in the New Testament. Let me just say something. Our mission isn't just removing something. We're not just here to remove something. We are not just here to be against things. We are here to reculturate everything with this God-inspired, God-installed life ethic. But that's why, look, we want to be open with you as a church about what we believe. This is why we teach about things like creation. Because we want young people, we want our society believing that the world we live in was made good, that it is the work of a good God. That we as human beings are not accidents, you know. We're not just a splat that's come out of some kind of thing that crawled out of the sea millions of years ago or whatever. That humans are God-made, God-imaged. We are the highest point in creation. I know the way we behave sometimes, we don't always show that, sadly. But you see, that's the problem with an anti-God viewpoint. That's where it will bring you. And so, you see, to us as believers in Jesus, the human life and the human person has huge value, huge dignity. Do you know why? Because the Bible tells us all the time, God is so mindful of us. Some of us may remember in school, we would say the Psalms occasionally, Psalm 8. What is man? The psalmist asked that you are mindful of him. What are humans that you are mindful of us, Lord God? Listen, you have made us little less than angels. Now I've got to tell you, I'd rather be thought of as little less than an angel than just a slightly more advanced animal, you know. Because how you think about yourself produces behaviours in you and attitudes in us. It's no point in us arguing about this. This is so well established now in social theory and education. How we think brings on... Listen, the Bible says, the Lord our God sets his affection on us. Listen, he remembers our human frame. He cares for all that he has made and he will make provision. See, that's why you're at Union Road, in the new perspective that we've gained on God's mission here through his help. It's not our own cleverness. We want to say something to your friends this morning, if you're listening in with us, it's very important. God's focus isn't just don't do. It's not don't do. It's bigger than that. Our God's focus is, come on, let's create good culture for families to grow and thrive in. Let's have a way of thinking and a way of living that helps us to fulfill our God ordained destiny. Now, what was God's ordained destiny? Good life for everyone. Care for those who are least able, you know? I think of Dawn and some of the other girls in the congregation and some of the people we know, you know, who served in the local surgeries and in the health service. Angela worked for years with children now in PMLD, you know, physically and mental learning difficulties. You see, and this is because as Christians, we want good life for everyone. We want care for the least able, for the elderly, for the marginalized, for the widows and the orphans. We want a positive community framework that's built from values of God's loving provision. And we want that applied socially. Now let me explain what that means. As Christians, we want a cooperative ethic. We want to learn to cooperate well. We don't want destructive competition all the time. Now, let me explain something. This might upset a number of people, but God-shaped culture is never the strong survive and the weak go to the wall. It has never been that. Bible culture is God's involved people desiring for all humanity, all family, all children, the same hopes and positive things we want for our family and our children. Now, if you come to me and answer, say, oh, do you want your Timothy, even though he doesn't come to church, you know, do you want your Timothy to have a good and positive life? Of course I want him to have a good and positive life. I'm his father. That's written in, isn't it? You know? Now, what Jesus challenges me and Angela and others to is something even bigger. And it's this. God wants us to want for every young person what we want for our Timothy. See it? The same hopes and positive things. And why is that? Because really, that is just, if we're going to talk about God connection, Jesus connection, God's great love has come to us, we say something, right, then God says, will you let that love that I've given you loose on your neighbours like yourselves? See? How positive it is. Now, of course, we've touched this morning, very briefly, on one of the most awkward themes in the Bible, scripture judgment. But even this scripture judgment, like all scripture judgment, this war judgment is limited. You see, God is about setting wrongs to rights. Now you see, when Israel were called to go to blow the trumpets and be at war against these anti-God, it was just against this one culture, not the whole world. God didn't say, you know, go and have a massive worldwide war. The only worldwide thing in the Bible is God's rescuing, renewing, restoring, recreative mission of love. If you say, can put it in simple language, for example, Lorna, okay. God wants to create again a vast rainbow nation of human beings of all ages and cultures in life connection with him through the Lord Jesus Christ's life and ministry, his death and resurrection and his return. Now, of course, if we're honest about it, we read this stuff and about, oh yeah, these far off cultures, yeah, well, we all know they were primitive and horrible. Hey, hang on. Last time I looked, our time wasn't too good to look at, was it? You know, I think of the terrible impact of Hitler's Holocaust. I did some research on this. I'm glad that Dr. Haydock's with us here in my congregation, just the few of us that are here this morning. See, it's right that we remember the terrible impact on Jewish people, that's right. But you know, it wasn't just Jewish people. I did a bit of research. It was Slavic people. He picked on the Russians, he picked on the Poles, he picked on the Czechs. And I didn't know this until recently. He had a terrible thing about people from Gypsy cultures. He terribly persecuted the Roma and Sinti people. He didn't like Jehovah's Witnesses. There was persecution of disabled children and adults. Anyone who was an opponent of the Nazi thinking, pacifists, conscientious objectors, trade unionists, Christians, both those of the Protestant confessing church who wouldn't support Adolf Hitler, and of Roman Catholic leaders who wouldn't. People who were homosexual, people who were homeless, unemployed, people who are receiving what we call social welfare. Addicts, prostitutes, they were all murdered in the death camps. All those groups of people, can you imagine it? Listen, we go on, it's right that we remember the six million Jewish people and add all these others to them and the number doubles or more. We've seen in our time the East European ethnic cleansings, the Cambodian killing fields, the communist gulag and re-education camp. And while we're at it, let me just say a few things about our own country, the United Kingdom here. In 2004, Trussell Trust, one of the leaders of food bank provision, had two food banks. Two. By 2015, they were feeding 1 million people alone. That's just Trussell Trust. So we've gone from 2004 from two food banks to 11 years to feeding 1 million people. Right now, in 2018, the Joseph Rowntree Foundation has established that there are something like 10 million parents and children in low-income working poverty. And what I mean by that is they're working and they can't make ends meet because they're on 0 hours or basic wage jobs. That 5 in 6 in low-income work will be in low-income work for over 10 years. That this morning in this United Kingdom of ours, 2 out of every 3 children and 1 out of every 5 people in working families are in poverty. In 2016 to 2018, the poverty figure in this country rose by another 1 million. And while you're digesting that, let me come even nearer home. In October 2020, social research proved that Blackburn was the highest Northwest child poverty increase in the whole of our country, with 50% of the children in the Blackburn Darwin area now regarded as living in poverty. 4 in 10 of children in the Northwest after housing costs are below the poverty line. In 2015 to 2019, the biggest poverty increases were in Blackburn, Darwin, Pendle and Burnley. And just in case you think, oh, this is on at Bridges with this bit of left-wing bias, these figures come from the Department of Work and Pensions in March 2020. And while we're on the subject, Hindburn's poverty increased by 65% from 31.9 to 38.4. In other words, 38 people out of every 100 living among us here in our borough are below the poverty line. Now, these children and these families will experience poor physical and mental health, educational attainment, and fewer future opportunities. In 2020, social research showed that Blackburn has the lowest UK wage intake of the whole country, approximately £383 a week. That's before tax and living costs are taken out. Let's be blunt about it, friends. These aren't things for pride. But I do want to say this this morning, and I hope there's a lot of people listening, not just because I want a big audience, but at Union Road here, we are proud of our wider community and the way they've rallied round us to help support things like the food bank. We've had people from businesses, from building firms, from pubs. We've had people in prisons. We had the lady Angela talked about who came in off the street with 3 bags yesterday, learned we were short of tin food, said she was going shopping and I don't know where she went, but she was back in five minutes with another 2 bags filled with tins. And we've had that again and again, people walking in off the street and giving. Now it's all right that people say, oh, so what? Listen, these awkward Old Testament passages, they show that our God chooses to work in and with and under human history and in with and under sinful and fallen humanity. When Jesus died on the cross, he was summing up all of God's war against all that is anti-God. Jesus died on the cross. That was the ultimate victory of all evil, human and superhuman. Well, thank you for the theory, Clona. What's that got to do with us? I'll tell you what it's got to do with us. Church inside out and church without walls is simply Jesus and the Spirit outworking of God's mission. This is God's missional character and mentality. We see it written large in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the book of Acts. Our God is missional. He is outgoing. He is nurturing. He is healing. He is rescuing and trust. Who wouldn't want to be involved with a God like this? And we see him so clearly in Jesus. Listen, this God of holy wholeness, he wants his whole church together. He wants us as his people, everyone, everywhere, every day, experiencing and expressing his character in our daily living. You see, we've said it a number of times, but we want to emphasize it this morning. In Jesus, going around avoiding things isn't enough. If Jesus' life is in my life, I've got to affirm things. I've got to long for other people to experience and express the personal fullness and well-being Jesus and the Spirit brings to me and to us as a church. And church inside out and church without walls is just our worldview longing here at Union Road. We tell you frankly that we want a church culture saturated with God's Holy Spirit. We want to see his gifts and his ministries working, not just because we want to see spectacular happenings, but because we believe the Gospels and the Book of Acts are our God's shape now for the church. Now, of course, this then, as we come toward the close, raises questions for our beliefs. Do we long together to experience and express Jesus and the Spirit culture, everyone, everywhere, every day? Do we all this morning see God's call to us, whatever age or state or style of a life we have, to live this culture daily? Do we understand that God wants us to be together a people who display and declare God's great rescue mission and show his love in sacrificial service? Do we understand together, everyone, everywhere, every day isn't a slogan, it's got to become our practice? Are we beginning to understand together? We're not just saved by the amount of our knowledge of the Bible and its ideas. You see, I have to say something that's very straightforward for everyone listening this morning, wherever you are on your journey with God. Jesus' life and Holy Spirit life is never just about me and my Jesus life. Jesus and the Spirit life always has an outward expression somewhere. In Jesus' life, in Jesus' connection life, I can no longer live only for myself and mine. Now, practically, this has to work itself up in all kinds of things. Now, some of this we've said before. This is why we challenge people when the church is open, when we've got stuff left from the food bank on Saturday, take stuff for others on your street. And then listen, the food's just an excuse to go knock on the door, really, and ask how they're doing. Did you get lots of chocolate at Christmas? Me and Sister Angela had quite a lot of chocolate, thank you very much. Well, if you feel it, it's a bit too much, you know, we're all doing a bit of weight watching, take some to your local surgery or your local chemist. Take some as a treat and say that you're from Union Road and you're grateful for their service this year. Now, some of us are bothered about COVID-19, I get that. We all bothered, aren't we? Well, look, if you're bothered and you don't want to go knocking on the door, pick up your phone and ring somebody outside your own family. Ask how they are. Be willing to change your schedule and do something for somebody else, you know? Acts of random kindness. You know, be willing to put yourself out. Maybe if one of the neighbours comes calling in distress or... Listen, we are beginning to discover in the work we do on the street and around in our community, you would be surprised how far small kindnesses go. Now, why do I make that point? Because when I read my Gospels, you see, Jesus' preemptive kindnesses, his miracles, his healings, his deliverances, they are often God's ways to impact people with kingdom connection. They were then, and let's be straight about it, they are now. And all of us can be involved. Maybe you're listening to me this morning and you've never really thought about a journey of life with God. Let me offer you this huge positive vision. This huge positive vision. Now listen, we're just not here as a church this morning to pretend we're perfect people. We're not. We screw up like everybody else. That's why we're Christians, you know? That's why we take communion. Or we just take it because it says so. We take it because we need to. But we are, with Jesus' help, involved in this great positive mission. And we want to invite you into connection with him so you too can be involved in it. And you too can start lighting some lights in the darkness that sometimes is around us. Angela said in a number of mornings as she closes off the service, but I'll say it this morning. Listen, if you want to think some more about this, we have some literature that can help. Just contact us through the Facebook. All we need is somewhere to send it to. It'll help you to think about what a real connection with Jesus and life in him can look like. But make no bones about it, it will be part of this great purpose of healing and recreation. But we invite you into that through Jesus this morning, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Dave, can you just take, thank you. Okay. Thank you for joining us today. We're going to sing our final song. And I will then show one of those leaflets on it was mentioning, if you'd like to join us. But we'll sing our final song, and then we'll say the grace together. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We would love to send you a travelling light. Please get in touch with us. And if you have any requests, we are through. If you get in touch with us on Facebook, if you have any needs, please get in touch with us. Somebody will ring you back or pray with you if that's what you would like. Let's say the grace together, this prayer ending. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. We look forward to you joining us again.